Faculté scientifique à l'Institut. D'ailleurs, je vous les présente dans l'ordre chronologique. La semaine prochaine, dans deux semaines plus tôt, jeudi le 30 avril à 14h, il y aura une conférence présentée par Katharina Dulit-Novaes, qui est professeure en philosophie. Le titre de sa présentation, c'est « Reasoning Biases and Non-Monotonic Logics, The Case of Preferential Logics ». La présentation a lieu, pour ceux qui s'intéressent, au W5215. L'information se trouve sur le site de Philopolis, Philo, F-I-L-L-O, Polis. La conférence sera suivie d'un cocktail. Voilà.
Ensuite, philosophie. Comme les filles.
En juin, Colissio 2015, qui portera sur les esprits attitrés. Pour ceux qui étaient avec nous la dernière fois, je l'avais mentionné. Je vous répète en anglais, Atypical Minds, the Cognitive Science of Difference and Potentialities, qui aura lieu le 8, 9 et 10 juin. I'd like to underline the fact that it's open and free. You can show up and attend all the conferences you want during those 3 days. Okay? And finalement, à l'automne, exceptionnellement, le cours pour les étudiants de la maîtrise et du doctorat, exceptionnellement, le cours ISC 8000 et ISC 9000 seront offerts conjointement par Pierre Poirier et le cours portera sur les architectures cognitives. Puis, en toute fin, je vous rappelle qu'en 2016, il y aura la prochaine école d'été en sciences cognitives qui portera sur le raisonnement. Voilà, alors Albert, je t'invite à nous présenter ton conférencier. Albert Lejeune, qui est notre représentant du pôle traitement des collègues.
Bonjour et bienvenue à tous. Je voulais surtout souhaiter la bienvenue au professeur Yogi. Last night you told me just call me George. Donc, le professeur Jungstrom, qui est très bien connu dans différents départements. Éducation, philosophie, cognition, informatique, management. Je dirais que comme j'avais l'idée en tête il y a 120 ans aujourd'hui, Slocum, le capitaine Slocum, a réalisé en 3 ans le premier tour du monde à la voile en solitaire. Il y a 120 ans, il partait aujourd'hui le 24 avril, je ne sais pas si c'était un vendredi. Et je dirais que comme lui, professeur Engelstrom, à naviguer sur des océans de cognition et à rencontrer des océans d'activité. Alors, il va nous en parler.
Merci.
In English tonight.
Thank you. I have to apologize that my French is practically non-existent because of negligence during the school years. And so I'll speak. And my topic is indeed concept formation in the wild, the notion in the wild may be familiar to you from the well-known book of Ed Hutchins, Cognition in the Wild. So it's I have borrowed that expression from Ed, but particularly this is not just about cognition in general, but specifically about concept formation. I try to make the argument that concepts and concept formation should be studied increasingly in actual life activities outside laboratory. Typically, concept formation and conceptual change are studied in laboratory settings or classroom contexts. And there, regularly, the focus is individual, and the concepts are predefined. In other words, there's something like typical well-established natural science, mathematics concepts, and the issue is how do individuals acquire them. However, in our everyday lives and work activities, we increasingly face the challenge of constructing and understanding concepts that are not well defined and are not indisputably clear. They're typically concepts that are emergent. Take, for instance, global warming or climate change or terrorism or whatever. Those concepts that we face every day, practically, for instance, in the media, they're clearly theoretically significant. There's a lot of research around them. At the same time, there's huge disagreements, disputes, even fights about the meaning and contents of those concepts. And they seem to evolve, sometimes even in ways which are very difficult to predict. And they also carry a lot of, let's say, ethical, political choices, visions of the future. So they're loaded. I like to call them concepts in the wild. Jim Greeno calls them functional concepts. So these are concepts which are embedded in life activities. They seem to be necessarily collective, complex, emergent, contested, and volitionally charged. And they have serious practical consequences. How a certain concept like that is actually understood, defined, or even perhaps sanctioned has significant consequences on people's lives. Here are a couple of quotes from Jim Greeno, who I think has nicely pointed out this dimension of concepts. Concepts and their meanings develop and evolve in settings of practice and are maintained in practices because they are useful in conducting the community's activities. And more recently, by a functional concept or a functional user concept, I refer to a cognitive entity that has meaning in a kind of activity in which it contributes to the way participants organize their understanding of what they are doing. So they're practice bound, they have practical consequences. And to push it a little further, my own particular interest could be located in a field where one dimension is the individual versus collective, and the other dimension is culturally given concepts versus a culturally emergent or new novel concepts. And my particular interest lies in the field where concepts are collectively constructed or formed, and they are, at least to some extent, culturally novel. They are not really fully predefined and given by the powers that be. And that's, in concept formation, that's not a very well understood field or area. If you go back in philosophical studies of concepts, perhaps Stephen Toulmin's work in 1972, Human Understanding, was to some extent an attempt to enter this domain. However, he looked at it through the history of science, rather than through practical activities that are constructing the future. And needless to say, the reception his book got from the philosophical community was no less than devastating. So he never wrote the second volume of that work. Perhaps the time is now different, hopefully. And since I'm not a philosopher, I don't have to worry about that so much. So, devastating or not, I'll try. But I need to warn you that this talk and the contents of it are work in progress. I do not claim that this is some sort of a complete, neat, well-controlled investigation or framework. It is something which is emergent in itself, and I very much welcome your comments and criticisms. There are more than needed. To me, the challenge of functional concepts can be specified in three questions. One is, there must be different kinds of them, different types of functional concepts. And what might those types be? Again, I'm not going to be able to suggest an exhaustive categorization of functional concepts, but I'll try at least initial distinctions and perhaps beginnings of some sort of a meaningful typology. Second, how are different types of functional concepts formed? And this means that I need to look at my cases as they evolve. In other words, much of this work is actual field work in settings where concepts are actually constructed and used. And thirdly, what kinds of instruments are used in the formation of different functional concepts? And this might sound rather odd, because usually when people study concepts and concept formation, concepts are taken to be pretty much standalone entities. Now, as far as I can see, in real life, we need all kinds of devices to make sense of challenging issues and to turn them into conceptualizations, perhaps even stable concepts. And these devices range from, so-called pre-existing knowledge to all kinds of material devices and representational tools in particular. In order to construct a concept, it typically has to represent itself, at least one would think so. Whether it's in models or in writing or in whichever modality. So I'm particularly interested also in the different modalities of representing those emergent functional concepts in real activities. I have three cases. This is an ongoing, fairly large-scale research project in which we have particularly been following and looking at the emergence of concepts in three settings. The first one of them is a group of carpenters building large wooden fishing boats at the Bay of Bengal in India. What's particular about this group is that they don't read or write. They build very large vessels without any drawings or blueprints. So it's a rather interesting case as such, also anthropologically. The second case is construction of a concept of collaborative pest management among greenhouse tomato growers in Finland. These people are facing the problem that there is a pest called whitefly, which destroys their crops, and they are used to working, each one of them, as an independent entrepreneur, even though they live in the same village. They're competitors, basically, with one another. But the problem is that the whitefly doesn't really respect the boundaries between these entities. It moves from one place to another. And so they face the challenge of doing something together. And there is, in fact, a sanctioned official concept, for instance, sanctioned by the European Union, which is called integrated pest management. Most of these farmers have never heard of it, or if they have, they are not particularly keen to look at the 100-page documents defining what is integrated pest management. They actually need to do something about this issue. So, in a way, like typically in many cases, you work with a real pressing situation that needs a conceptualization. At the same time, there are, of course, all kinds of offerings, sometimes coming from above, telling you that this would be the right way to do it. But it might be just simply too clumsy and complicated to implement something which is given. And the third case is creation of a concept of sustainable physical mobility for all people living at home and receiving home care in the city of Helsinki. For them, the issue is that people are increasingly kept at home when, you know, an increasingly large percentage of people are old in our society, at least in Finland and like in many other places. And it's very expensive to put them in any institutions. And so, and it seems that it might be even more humane to keep them as at home as possible, as long as possible, although it's not always so sure. But it's definitely cheaper. And then the situation emerges that, surprisingly enough, many of these people who are living at home alone with various kinds of illnesses rapidly start losing their physical mobility. And this is particularly pertinent in places like Finland and Canada, where part of the year is very slippery. So if you go out, you fear for falling. And this might lead to permanent loss of mobility, for instance, breaking your hip. Therefore, you're very conscious of the danger of movement. And so this requires that somehow a concept is developed that allows these people to somehow keep or develop and nourish their physical mobility, because it is well known that the loss of physical mobility often is connected to the loss of other aspects of human agency and independence, including cognitive and other functions. So, these are the three sites in which we have done longitudinal field work, and I will discuss these sites through these three questions. So the first question was, what types of functional concepts may be identified? And the first case is the building on these wooden fishing boats at the Bay of Bengal. These are some images. We chose this purposefully because it looks like nothing new is created. This is a very old craft, and the model of the ship is also quite old. They have been building this specific type of boats perhaps 100 years. It is not known. There is no history written about this particular kind of boat, but it's a demanding vessel to build, and at the same time it challenges the idea of concept formation as constructing something new. So you might say, is this just simply repeating what is already here? Now, like I said, these people, it's a group of carpenters who come move to the village where the fishermen live at a certain time of the year and work there for a few months to build at least one, if not two, boats for the fishermen. They have no drawings or blueprints, hardly any representational devices, even the tape measures are very, very rare. In a way, you could say that the boat is its own representation. There is, when we asked them to describe or name the boat, they didn't understand the question. It's there. They could. In other words, and when we presented photographs of the boat to them, it was the first time they had seen these photographs, and they found it rather funny. It was, for them, it was a very peculiar. Why would anybody need a photograph of the boat? It's right there, and there are plenty of them also on the sea. So if you want to go to the harbor, check it out for yourself. There is the boat. In other words, it is something where that you. My claim is that this is an interesting case where you could argue that the physical object is its own concept. Most of the builders have minimal schooling and cannot read or write, like I said. Yet this 80-meter-long fishing boat is completed in time and becomes a seaworthy vessel that passes strict government inspection. Each year this happens, it is rather amazing. And these boats are used to carry out fishing trips, which keep them for 12 days at a time in open seas. So they are operating in very, very demanding conditions. I would call this as a prototype, concept as a prototype. Now, this is not to be confused with the notion of prototype concepts put forward by Eleanor Roche already in the 1970s. Let me try to explain what I mean by prototype. The material object here is its own concept. It is not represented in any other stable external medium. Each boat, in a way, is a prototype of itself, similar to previous ones, but also a unique individual. There's always some significant differences between the individual cases. At the same time, they are, each one of them represents clearly a shared continuous model. Now, compare this to another case that's been written about by David Turnbull, Jules Foucault here, and others, namely the medieval cathedrals. In fact, Fauconnier and Turner write about the Gothic cathedral. The building becomes modified in imagination so as to accept topological projections from the theological space. Over generations and generations, theologians elaborate this blend, and those who present the theology use it. The result is a fabulous emergent concept, namely the Gothic cathedral. So they take the Gothic cathedral as its own concept. Is a concept in itself. And Turnbull describes the construction of the Chartres cathedral. The design is not a well-controlled and harmonious entity, but a mess. Altogether, there were 9 different contractors or master masons who took between 25 and 30 years to build the cathedral in 30 distinct campaigns. There were 13 major design and structural changes in that 30-year period, but there was no overall designer. Just a succession of builders. It was the ad hoc accumulation of the work of many men. Again, there were no drawings. It seems that the early and most classic cathedrals were built without drawings, without blueprints, and without an architect. So it has some interesting similarity. And what I'm saying here is that it seems rather interesting possibility, at least, that we could think of one type of concepts as being representations of themselves rather than concepts about something. It's a little bit like when we talk about the concept car. You know, it means that it's a model. It can be a car that you can actually drive. At the same time, it represents a possible car. In this case, the concept boat is not just a possible boat, but it's already a boat that is continuously used and built. So that's the first case. Now the second case, it's collaborative pest management among greenhouse tomato growers. This is their village, an aerial photo of their village, and the challenge is the following. You have the individual perspective of the individual greenhouse grower here, and the problem is that the whitefly flies around and crosses boundaries between the different farms, and this requires a collective perspective. In other words, how do you move from this notion that each one of us takes care of his own business. To something like, we need to master this threat, this pest, in a through a joint effort. So it's not so much conceptualizing the pest as a biological creature, although that's a big part of it. They need to understand the behavior of this pest, but more than that, they need to understand their own behavior and to reorganize it to meet the challenge of the pest. So, just briefly, to look into the what they came up, they came up with was an entirely new model for their own activity, in which they have to operate together to monitor the pest and to prevent its proliferation. This happened through multiple steps of modeling, and typically the concept serves as a device for diagnosing states of a complex system. In this case, the states of how much pests are and where, and how are we supposed to eliminate them or prevent their proliferation. The concept is typically represented as a graphic or mathematical model, or a series of models, which depict reciprocal causal connections. Often, a whole series of models are needed to construct and apply the concept. Again, if you use a comparative case, this is the work of Nancy Nersessian on model-based reasoning. She has studied various groups of laboratory scientists and how they construct their concepts through model-based reasoning, as she calls it. The concept in this case emerges in efforts to simulate complex real phenomena. In other words, the concept is a systems model, a dynamic systems model. Nersessian writes, engineering scientists think by means of the artifact models they design and build. They translate their understandings of the phenomena under investigation into real-world simulation models and revise their understandings through simulation. Model systems are what sociocultural studies of science refer to as the material culture of the community, but are also what cognitive studies of science refer to as cognitive artifacts, participating in the representational reasoning and problem-solving processes of a distributed system. Novel concepts can emerge from systems in the course of experimenting via these machineries, as she calls them. So the models themselves form a complex machinery, quote unquote, which it's generative. It generates new models as it's used and put into practice. And this is exactly what was emerging among those tomato growers with the help of a couple of extension workers and a biologist who were working with them. Perhaps not as sophisticated as laboratory scientists would have generated, but very functional and quite similar in many respects. And the third case, the issue of sustainable mobility in home care of the elderly in Helsinki. Our standard concept of physical mobility is typically dominated by three features. It's achievement-oriented, separate from ordinary life, and very individualistic. The image of a physically mobile human being often is associated with an athlete or an adventurer or some kind who performs nice feats with his or her body, and in that sense represents also a youthful image of mobility. This does not very well fit with this. How does our standard concept of physical mobility apply to all sick people living at home? And so this was the need for a novel concept. If you ask these people to engage in physical exercises,
that's not necessary, you know, jump up and down and do this and that, perhaps build a box, kickboxing, it's not necessarily a very good idea. So something else needed to be constructed. What we did with this case was that together with the home care services of the health care, public municipal health care of the city of Helsinki, we started to implement a simple what was called mobility agreement. In other words, the home care worker would go to the client's home on a regular visit and present the idea that why don't we design a few physical exercises which we can do partly together, partly perhaps you can do them alone, and we agree which ones they are and we follow up and see how they fit in your everyday life.